A strong Europe needs a strong scientific landscape. And this question should raise our collective effort to understand the future of Europe, but certainly where we are and where we should be in terms of the scientific developments, but also the relation between society and science at general. And this is very timely, this discussion, because we have just initiated the conference on the future of Europe. Where are we? Europe at general invests about 2% of GDP on R&D. And this was and has been a target which is far away from the value which was defined in the year 2000, and very recently the Commission, in a very important communication, have stressed again the need to evolve to 3% of GDP. But why we have not been able to do it until 2020, and why we need to strengthen these targets for the coming decades? Because we understood more than ever, particularly in the times that we face with the COVID-19, that the only way to provide the sustainable development of future generations is with more knowledge and better knowledge. And we should address this from a societal point of view. For society at general, to prevent future pandemics, but also to face the unique opportunities the digital transition is open to us, at the same time to face the challenges of the green transition, we need new knowledge. We don't know enough how to cap and to couple the necessary changes we need to face in the daily life to accomplish the targets of the decarbonization of our economy with the idea of using more digital means. And requiring more knowledge means, above all, more science and more devotion to research and the development. But it needs more. It needs certainly more knowledge, but it needs also a new collaborative effort across the disciplines and across institutions. In other words, it means institutional innovation. And it is not enough. We need more knowledge. We need a new framework for institutional collaboration and the opening up of our institutions to the transdisciplinarity of knowledge, but we also need more observation methods, particularly those which more and more can be provided by low orbit satellites through high resolution image. And these three issues, new knowledge, institutional innovation and new observation methods, will certainly be critical for Europe to achieve a leading position in the coupling between the opportunities of digital transition and the must of the green transition. And we know that we need to do this together with building a resilient context, what, in other words, is the strategic autonomy of Europe. We understood during the COVID-19 that, for instance, pharma in Europe depends 80% of materials imported from elsewhere. But the same applies in other areas. For instance, in the development of a new generation of solid-state lithium cells for batteries of the future. Or when we look at the hydrogen economy. The future of our economies and societies will always be a skilled society. And to attract more talent, we need more science. Again, the relation between where we are and where we should be is the one which really requires a collective effort in training our population, in facilitating the reskilling and the upskilling of our population, and this needs more science. And to have more science, we need to specialize, but also diversify our landscape and guarantee that no one is left behind. No single European region should be left behind out of this discussion. And this per se is a great challenge throughout Europe. We know that we still have large disparities at an European-wide context between the concentration of knowledge and the production of knowledge in some zones which have not been have access to knowledge. And again, we need always to look at science in a competitive, excellent way. But we must also guarantee that the access to excellence is given to everyone. Everyone should be able to access to excellence. Everyone should be able to compete for excellence and guarantee an inclusive nature of the scientific development of Europe is very much associated with the social dimension of Europe. The recent social summit organized in the city of Porto during the Portuguese presidency is very clear in terms of the social dimension of Europe and in terms particularly of breaking boundaries about the inequalities which still persist in our society. And therefore, this idea to have an Europe more digital, more green, more resilient, but more social, has still a fifth attribute, which is always a Europe which is global. This has become part of our way to look at society, to attract talent from all over the world and to guarantee a context which is open to the world. But all these attributes are very much associated with the idea of science in Europe, a science open to everyone, a science which is social, and a science which is also resilient, using the opportunities of the digital transition and facing the challenge of a responsible and green transition. And again, this is not new, but we need to have a collective effort. More than 70 years ago, John Zeman, an European intellectual from Cambridge, wrote "Science is Real." And he essentially showed us that science is a social construct. 10 years later, he, in his book Reliable Knowledge, he clearly put emphasis on the context of the public understanding of science and of the need to engage population at large on this process of this of the social construct of a scientific landscape. During the last decades, we have very important movements throughout Europe, from La Ciencia La Paz in France, the Ciencia Viva movement in Portugal, where I am today, and many others have shown how important is the link between science and society, between society and science. Training science in the young kids throughout the entire life will become a must in all our societies. And we should not forget that we live times of long lives. And within the process of aging of the European society, we need to understand that we also need more science for the elderly. Again, a strong Europe is a Europe that no one is left behind. And therefore, science is for the youngsters, but science is also for the elderly, for those more vulnerable, where we need more and more to use science for a new and emerging intergenerational debate between those with a long life and those which are younger and need to be in continuous debates about the way we can use science, we can use vaccines, but also the way we can use engineering sciences or the humanities to make a better life between our common goal of a better Europe and a greater European context. And this puts a critical question, because science is a social construct, but science needs time and space. Space, as I mentioned, is because every single European region needs to have access to the scientific development. Time because science takes time, and we don't have that time available. And we have just look at the COVID-19, where the time to develop a vaccine was very much compressed. And this was important because of two essential attributes. The fundamental knowledge and the fundamental sciences that do exist in our, or at least in some of our scientific institutions, in close articulation with the capacity to make disruptive innovations, particularly through startups. And we should be proud that in Europe we have now incentives to foster fundamental science, including the European Research Council, and we have disruptive startups and innovations that we hope will be further promoted through the European Innovation Council. And again, the articulation of fundamental knowledge and disruptive innovation will be critical to keep the time adequate for the development of science, always putting people in the center of our the development. And therefore, I believe that a greater Europe with greater science is a science for people, and essentially is a people-driven process. Thank you very much for your attention.